All right, let's call the meeting to order. Hopefully, David will join us at some point. All right, folks, so two agenda items for tonight. One is to talk about background from the financial forums and potentially for additional financial forums. And in the packet are a couple of things. One is the note that we used to kind of form the basis of the financial forum last time, or form the basis of discussion. The second, the second is what we use for the basis of discussion. The third is some feedback. Sorry, I keep going out of order. The third is a piece that I wrote on free cash that I thought would be a good description of what it is, just to try to give everybody a basis for what's going on. You know, all subject to discussion, but I thought I'd take a shot at it. And then the last piece is a compilation of some feedback that I received from some folks on those topics that may help us to kind of put together what we're thinking about here. So I know that Bill, you've mentioned that you had some comments that you wanted to share.
Yeah,
so
if you want to pass those. Great.
I think they're part of the packet already, Bill, if they're what you gave me.
Page four.
That's right.
Do you have copies back there?
Yes, I do.
Do
you have
great.
Thank you. I just have that. That's your
whole show will stop if I don't have money.
Okay. You people want feedback from the financial forum, so I'm going to give you some. I'm sure you've read this. They advocated for an override of Prop 2.5 as you did at the September 40th. 2016 financial forum, the finance committee forgot its role to play the town meeting process. Section 2.12.2 of Article 2 of the Town of Reading Home Rule Charter, Section 3.3.2.1 of the bylaws, and Section 5.1 Department of Local Services guidelines spell out the role and responsibilities of the committee. Section 2.12.2 states that in addition to investigative powers, the primary role is, quote, the Finance Committee shall submit a written report to town meeting setting forth its findings, approvals, or disapprovals of all articles in the warrant that involve expenditures of funds. Section 5.1 of the DSL states in part, Finance Committee will establish a representative group of taxpayers to conduct a thorough review of municipal financial questions on behalf of all its citizens. And I repeat that, all its citizens. In advocating for an override, the committee, in my opinion, has lost sight of its role and responsibilities to all the citizens and overstepped that role. While I feel that the financial forum are useful in the future, in my opinion, they should be chaired by the Board of Selectmen, and the Finance Committee should be of service so they could do as the Charter and the DSL suggest and advise town meeting their primary role and responsibilities. Thank you.
Thank you. Comment
from? Any comments?
Just so you all know, and I don't know if you know this, Bill, Tom Ryan also wrote to the FinCom with a somewhat similar angle on page 3.
And I don't think this committee, I think over the years, the finance committees have grown and looked at that. And if you read the charter in DSL, that is not your role. Your role, quite frankly, is just advice on town meeting. And I like the financial forum. I think they're great. And another one, too. No abstention votes on meeting, please.
Shouldn't have tried to add that one, though.
Robert's rules of order.
Separate topic.
That's all right. Oh, I got your attention.
So I guess I would make one comment if others don't. So very specifically to actually two of the points you brought up here. 5.1, finance committees were established so a representative group of taxpayers could conduct a thorough review of municipal finance questions on behalf of all citizens. So I guess in my view, the municipal finance questions that come up are not only the looking at the exact numbers that are there, but it's also looking at the welfare of the community, which would include what's the impact on property values, potentially? What's the impact on the kinds of services that the town can offer? Now, we're not here to advocate, but we're here to make it very clear that if certain things happen, there is an ability for the town to do what both the town side and the school side have advocated they need. With current revenue sources, that's not available right now. So the town does need to make a decision. I think my personal opinion and advocacy here is that the taxpayers should be allowed to make that determination.
No question. But they should be allowed to. But
absolutely.
My feeling is that it should be led by the Board of Selectmen. And the Finance Committee should sit there and listen and make your recommendations to town meeting as the charter says.
And not
advocate for an override, one way or the other.
Right. But I guess I'd come back to those same words that we just quoted in 5.1. Conducting a thorough review of municipal finance questions on behalf of all citizens. There's no question that the description of Prop 2.5 and any change, any overrides, that has to come from the Board of Selectmen. That's 100% clear. I've also looked at that document. I'd be happy to share it with you.
Okay, I've heard 5.1.
And it's also very clear that in that document that municipal employees, including members of committees, are allowed to state their opinions. They're not allowed to use town resources. They're not allowed to actually raise, I guess they can't raise funds, although they can contribute. But I did have a chance to look at those things just to kind of understand what's there. Any other questions or comments?
I think at our financial forum, I do not recall any recommendations made by any members of the Finance Committee for an override. I think that I recall that care was taken not to do so, recognizing that any kind of vote or recommendation would come from the Board of would be initiated and would come from the Board of Selectmen. And I viewed what the Finance Committee did at the Financial Forum to be providing more information to the town about the state of the town's finances and what our options are moving forward to address the state of the town's finances.
Further comments, questions?
The wonderful thing about democracy is we have the right to our own opinions.
Absolutely, absolutely. And it's important to share. And important to share.
And I appreciate your comments, and I think it's a reminder for us to how we conduct our business and to be, continue to be very mindful of staying within our mandate and our directive and our authority.
I guarantee you would.
Well, so
when I make 50 at town meeting, then I'll decide whether I want to stay at my
So I think that what we have been discussing and kind of this first item on the agenda here is to look at creating a factual document.
Yes.
That does outline the situation and helps to explain some of the complexities that, frankly, the town and the schools go through in preparing a budget, and that we investigate in some depth and then report back to town meeting on our findings and recommendations. And the feeling that I think we had actually in the past few years, and then most recently last town meeting and then our financial forums, has been that there needs to be some clear information laid out, clear factual information, and transparent information. So this document was meant to be a first pass at the kinds of topics that might be there, that might be appropriate for that. So hopefully everyone's kind of gone through it a couple of times at this point. I think what I thought would be very helpful is to think about, number one, what subset of this information or changes to it are appropriate so that we can start to create that factual document.
Is this already on the, it would be on the Finance Committee website, but is it on the town's website in a way that's easy to navigate?
It's nowhere yet.
It's nowhere yet, okay.
Right, we haven't approved minutes from the forum.
Okay.
So, no, this isn't published yet.
Okay.
So actually...
It was given out in the forum.
It was given out at the forum. It was included in the packet.
Right, it is sort of out there, so to speak.
It's public, but I guess it's not easily
accessible.
It might have been on the website as part of your packet then.
Right, right.
Yes, it was.
That was exactly what I was thinking.
That's, in terms of what Mark's comment is, it's not in minutes yet, and that's usually where people look.
Okay, that's like the official, okay.
Yeah, it was circulated to all the boards that were invited. So all the members of all the boards that were invited to the forum received it. But from a public point of view, I think those that came, great, and those that didn't, maybe didn't see it.
And just as a little bit of a side note, Bob, some of those charts you showed, I thought were extremely effective.
Oh, really? That's interesting.
Yeah.
And is your presentation on there, on the website?
The website's being rebuilt now, so we've tried not to add too much.
Got it.
It should be done in about 2 weeks.
Okay. It seemed like there was interest among members of the public.
A number of people have emailed me, and I've sent it to them.
Sent it to them. Yeah, it seemed like there was interest in having the presentations and the materials provided at the financial forum made, you know, easily accessible.
Yeah,
which makes me wonder if we did that, then whether we would want to, like, you know, provide, if people were interested in everything that we talked about, you know, we put this up in terms of how we presented it at the meeting, but then have something that's a little simpler for, as the next step.
Exactly. I think that's where we want to get to, is how do we kind of, you know, shrink this down. The forum was available on RCTV, because I know Tom Ryan told me that he watched it on RCTV, so I know it's there and has been, you know, available, and possibly on YouTube, I don't know, but certainly through RCTV. So, yeah, I'd love to kind of think about what are the key points. I mean, I know we had one discussion about it should be a postcard-sized piece at the end of the day in terms of very few points, but just made clearly. We could do pages and pages and pages, and I don't think they'll have any value. I think we've got to come down to just a couple of key points, basically. And again, the notion here, I think, that we talked through is that this would kind of become the factual baseline for discussion. And there'll be advocates who want to go in one direction, there'll be advocates who want to go in another direction. That's fine. I think we'd like to get the facts out there.
Did we get any feedback from the other boards as to what they thought were the important points? I understand they each had their own sort of set of things that they want to be thinking about, but did we get feedback saying, okay, this one seemed important, that one seemed important, just so to help us narrow it down?
Not yet is okay. The answer. I think there is a desire to have some discussions about you know, what their opinions would be,
sure,
and how that would play out. And I think each board will do that by itself.
Okay.
But it would be wonderful still, I think, to have kind of a base document.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
And we've received some feedback, some of the feedback that's here, but I've had informal conversations with a number of other people who said, you know, how do we kind of sift through all this? How do we kind of get down to the core of, you know, where are we? You know, what decisions will be brought to us? And what's the impact? Right, at the end of the day? So if you look at starting on page 12, you'll see... I didn't actually do this intentionally, that's how it came out. I kind of highlighted some areas that I thought might be the way to whittle it down, that these might be the core issues, but I'm...
What, the highlighted ones?
Yeah, I thought that the highlighted ones
might
be the core ones to include.
Oh, good. From what I see so far, good. Because I think number one isn't up to us, sort of, to some of the points. It's, to me, it's up to school and town to discuss that.
Yes. Yeah, okay, I think
good.
Exactly right.
Mm-hmm.
I think that free cash, everyone I speak to, no one has... a real clear understanding, I think myself included, but no one has a real clear understanding of what it is. And I think it's important to lay out some description. There's an attempt here to do that on page 11.
Sending us the other direction, trying to throw us off.
Sorry, I didn't see the early pages. My page count is off. But I mean, I don't think we have to go into that detail quite yet. But I think, to me, I hear from everybody, they don't understand what free cash is. And there's a question about, well, you know, if it's really free, why aren't we using it?
And can I have some?
Right. So I think it's important to...
Can we change the name of it? That came up at some point, but.
Right, because seriously, why do, why do we?
It's a terrible name.
It's a technical term that is factual. You know, you don't have to use it in public. You can call it cash reserves or whatever.
Right.
Yeah.
Because it's a subtle change, but I think it's more appropriate.
And the only time it has to be used is in a motion, you know, in a warrant report.
Oh, it really does. It can't be referred to as cash reserves.
No.
Such a bizarre name. It really is. Okay.
And I think we can suggest that it's referred to in a different way.
Maybe that's a good thing to do.
But I think somehow explaining what it is, how it's used, the fact that we have been using some of it on an annual basis to support the operating budget. And as of right now, in fact, this is a later topic that I'll bring it here just for a second. We are on the state aid that's in the budget. We're about $125,000, $130,000 behind.
We balanced the budget without needing more free cash.
Exceptional.
Vocational education enrollment was down quite a bit. Just found that out 2 weeks ago.
That's an accommodated cost.
That's great. Okay, so, all right, next that comment. What I was going to say is that we have to.
Sharon and I just decided let's balance it this way and let's not tell the schools or the town they can have more money. Seems sensible at this point in the budget.
Great, okay, so we'll save that topic for later.
That does leave health insurance still out there, and that's 1 or 2 weeks away.
Oh, 2 weeks, okay, because I was asking, you're like, oh, you might know tonight.
No, not yet.
Yeah, sorry, I went out of order. That's actually a 17 question. Let's kind of come back to here. So if free cash is a chunk, and then I think the comments that are here on page 12 in terms of giving it context would be very interesting. Level of free cash versus peer communities. I think that's actually a chart you created already. Mm-hmm. That was one of the ones you presented. And then the discussion of the recommended level. So, you know, 5% is by policy. We've had discussions about changing it, though we've not come to any conclusions. So I think that, to me, that's a chunk that should be there. And it probably needs to be a paragraph or two, ideally. Not quite as much as this here. I think the average tax bill by community chart is great. I think that there is a lack of understanding of, you know, how we compare. I hear people make statements frequently thinking that we're definitely way above everybody else. I think it's helpful just to state, here's where we are. Here's the comparison to other towns.
It might be helpful, and it just may not necessarily work when we're talking about that postcard, but providing concrete examples of what a comparison to a similar town looks like. Are we talking, do they have more open town hall hours or less? When we talk about, libraries are slightly different, under a different heading, but what concrete services can we actually compare and say, well, we offer this, but this town doesn't.
That's almost impossible to do. So we've talked a lot about it. I have volumes of survey data about services, mm-hmm. Just internal, about what we offer. And then we started comparing the peers. It's apples and apples. Hours is easy. Libraries open, you know, 84 hours a week or whatever the different libraries are. That's simple. You'll see in the budget write-ups this year, there's some C-Clicks fixed data for DPW, for instance, but most other communities don't have it. So to compare service either in quality or quantity is very hard. Schools are a little easier, but unfortunately for schools, it's kind of the soundbite of just a couple numbers and measures, which isn't always thorough either. So that's a tough area. It'd be great if we could. I'd love to know, first of all, how do we really compare?
Because I think that if there's a way that we can find even a couple that are apples to apples,
yeah.
I don't know if it's possible, but I think it would go a long way because it's hard to understand when there isn't anything legitimately to compare it to. So
right.
The taxes are what they are, but what are we really getting bang for our buck compared to other towns?
Yeah, I'll give you one example just because it happened last week. It's a restaurant town that just opened. They're kind of up and down the East Coast at this point. I don't want to give them free advertising, though. They said it was really helpful the way Reading had what's called a DRT, where there's a bunch of people in this room all at once to have a conversation instead of you have to go chase the fire chief, the town engineer, the planner, and they may contradict each other. Mm-hmm. That's a really strong service that we offer that most communities don't, but how do you measure that? Seasoned developers and business people love that. entrepreneurs don't really know that that's not normal, so they can't compare. But that's an example of how we generally like to work in a more efficient way. For us too, it saves our time. We're all hearing the same thing. We're all hearing each other's comments. And for the developer, again, the seasoned developer likes it. You know, the developer that's trying to sneak around, not so much, because he can then go say, well, the fire chief said this. Well, no, he didn't. So that stuff's hard to measure. That's all sort of qualitative story. How do you measure that? And that just came up because it was just last week.
Is there any service level, service satisfaction rating? And I'm sure it's not the same across towns, even if there was.
No,
I mean, if there's anything like that.
You know, we've conducted surveys, but that stuff on online and in green cards, and we have 97% excellent or good service levels. That seems okay. You know, I don't know what percent of the people came in mad, but it was probably more than 2 or 3%. So that's not such a bad number. But again, how do you compare? What does it measure against? Eventually, our business is going to be more data-driven. It's just it's a hard transition to get there.
And I think we're up against perception. Isn't that really what it is?
Yes.
Anyway, right? I mean, it's all perception. And if we compare ourselves to a certain town, whatever that town may be, you know, it's either a shortfall or we think we're ahead. So,
yeah.
And I think, you know, when it comes down to sort of stating the facts, I think that's the perception we need to play to appropriately, saying, hey, you know, generally the feedback we're getting is they think we're here, but we're really here. And I think that the taxes is the only kind of level playing field that I can see, but I don't know how other people feel.
I agree. I think services and whether you're happy to services, perception, and there's no apples to apples comparison you can make.
Yeah.
It's going to be at once.
Even if you could make it, I don't know if it would hold water. Because right. I think you'd still be fighting that perception.
Still, you were cherry picking.
Right. Like I honestly don't know if it would.
And you'd be fighting over the definition the whole time.
And yet, as a resident, you'd have to live in six places to really know how to compare anyway. So.
Right.
Each precinct. Each precinct. So is there really much else we can add to that, or it may just be that what is the average tax bill, just so people know?
Or, there was some level of service, David, that you had in your presentation about it, wasn't there? Was it dollars spent?
It was just how we allocate budget dollars.
Oh, how we allocate.
With no measure of whether it's effective or not.
Yeah, with it. Okay.
Was this the area, or may have missed it in another, where we were asked to compare MCAS scores in the same, was it?
Yes.
Compare MCAS scores in the same space as we're comparing property tax bills?
Yeah, they did ask that.
Yeah, that's true.
And I think Dr. Doherty, I think, was going to
address that one.
Yeah.
Try to do that.
Number of employees based on the population compared to?
The problem with that is, again, so what's better? Fewer? More?
Somebody would say, yeah.
Per capita of employees? I'm not sure what you
measure.
There's
a lot of school data available online on that, because I've looked, mm-hmm. just out of curiosity. I don't know what I concluded, other than a lot of data.
I think our mission here really has to be kind of the smallest amount of factual data that we can provide. The goal would be that it's less controversial because mm-hmm. it's fact.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, that would be kind of the core document. Again, advocates on either side can do whatever they want if we kind of define the discussion in facts. I think that's what our job is, I think.
I did have a question on the chart you were showing with those communities. Were those the list communities that one consultant?
They were a combination of our last two consultants. So the first one had 22, and the second one added 3. So there's 25 now.
Okay, but it was those 25.
Because
I do think when we put up a chart, I think it's good to say where we got these communities, a third party, because
right, we didn't pick
as a cynic, I would tend to look up there and go, okay, I see why you picked. So I think it's important to say that.
And frankly, I may not agree what the second consultant did. He added in 3 wealthier communities. But mm-hmm. it doesn't really change the base data for mm-hmm. 25.
But I think it's just important that this isn't us just choosing random communities.
Okay.
Based on what we think is a like community, a third party desire.
What's really interesting is a number of the communities around us ask different questions among peers. Every single one of them has a different list of peers, and we're all like within 6 miles of each other.
Yeah.
But it's just funny how they all do that.
Right. One thing I did do was I asked Dr. Dari if he would consider using the same list.
On one of his charts, I thought he did.
They definitely overlap.
Yeah. Okay, because I think that's important too.
Yeah, it'll just help to have the discussion.
It just adds credibility, which is, when we're talking about perception, credibility.
Yeah,
and
the good part about the three communities that were recently added is they're the ones who Reading schools typically like to compare themselves because they like to aspire to be like Lexington, for instance. So again, that's not horrible to have that as one of 25 communities. It's not going to steer the data that much.
And it gives people a comparison point too. If they
right.
hold something up as an idol or as a problem, and they can find it there.
I have one comment regarding number 5, which was the Prop 2.5. There's the third bullet refers to how the population of Reading aging. I would like to mention that perhaps aging may not be the best word to use because it implies only the older population. But we also have a growing, very youthful population in the town as well. So if we make mention of that, I just want to be sensitive to language so that we address both ends of the spectrum.
I think one of the questions here was in thinking about folks with school-aged children as one segment of the population, and another segment being folks that are requiring non-school services, and what are those services? And you've raised the point a number of times. I think it was it MAPC? It wasn't MAPC.
Yes.
It was MAPC.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the general trend toward aging in place is a trend that's happening, and the expectation would be that Reading will have that also.
That was also done by Northeastern, the EDSAT report, which is maybe a little broader than MAPC is. That was going to be the fastest growing segment of Reading's population was the over, I think it was actually over 65.
And as the services, if and as the services, service needs are different, you know, that's something that has to be incorporated as the town's thinking about the budgets and how many people are working, what groups, what services do we need to offer, that needs to be included there as well. So that was the notion of it, but I think your point's well taken also. It's we've got to service the entire community is the point. And again, it's the town's job, it's the school's job.
That first bullet on number 5. Bob, I thought your chart was, that's just now remembering some of the charts. There was one chart showing.
Staggering. Down 50% in real terms over 14
staggering.
Years.
Yeah. That was really powerful. That was
yeah.
a great chart.
I think we address it in another place as well.
I mean, that really got, that was that first
well,
bullet.
I think the most important thing to communicate to voters is Reading different? And if it's different, why is it different?
Mm-hmm.
Why do you need an override? Did you do something wrong? Is that why you need it? And, you know, the answer from the 18 years I've been doing this is, you know, you could do everything right and it just keeps putting it off, but it doesn't really eliminate the need every so often to do it or to settle for this. I think the community at large does not have any understanding of this is a fundamental recurring need. That's going to happen no matter how well your government works and your schools work.
Mm-hmm.
And it's from a variety of factors, such as there's a lot of school kids, a lot of miles of road to take care of, or a cut-through community, and so on and on. It's just a never-ending list. But Reading is different than even some of our neighbors in that regard. Stoneham has slightly less roads, but similar, but way less kids. You know, Melrose has as many kids, way less roads. So there's just all kinds of, and I'm only picking two, there's all kinds of measures. We don't have much commercial, that's another big factor compared to any of our neighbors or any of our peers. I think Milton is the only lower one.
And I don't even know that we're different. I think all communities are struggling with,
oh yeah,
you know, needing adjustments every
most of them are. I mean,
few years,
cities typically
is.
Don't do overrides. But cities typically have a much more diverse economic base, so the single-family property tax bill is not a huge source of income.
whereas it is here. I was really shocked when I got into Boston's budget at how much, if you will, non-general fund money there is that runs that city. A lot of it is payment in lieu of taxes, all the universities and hospitals. Mm. It's quasi-public-private money. There's just so much of it. Mm. They have some phenomenal technology efforts funded that way because it's not general fund money. They can actually plan for 5 to 10 years of spending real money and not having to cut it. So, you know, cities are, by their nature, very different. But I don't think that there's a good understanding in the community necessarily of that basic fact.
Right. If you look at page 8 for a minute, which is the kind of the early description of this Prop 2.5 notion, you know, this was the first attempt at looking at, okay, where are we constrained on the revenue side and what's happening on the cost side? And I think that's got to be part of that whole discussion. Again, laying out, here's the situation. I don't think state aid is even mentioned. Well, it's here, decrease in state aid to cities and towns. But to get very specific with that chart would be great.
See, I felt like your chart just went to that point.
Yeah, I agree.
When you can show it in a picture, it's so much more effective.
Agreed. Absolutely agreed.
That was shocking.
There was one point in this book where you did talk about, I'm having a hard time finding it now, where you did talk about spending versus revenue. And I think that actually explains it nicely.
Is that the top of page 9? That was kind of accommodated costs? Is that what you're thinking of, or a different one?
You specifically address spending, essentially addressing the question of, is it an issue of mismanagement versus an issue of revenue? And I just don't know what that is.
Is it the...
Maybe it's in the free cash section? No.
Page 13 at the very bottom.
Yeah, that's right. I was 13, 14, yeah, that's what I was thinking. Is that okay?
We have a new problem.
Is that it?
The last bullet.
Yep. So maybe what we need to do is we have kind of, there's a revenue discussion slash charts, and there's a spending discussion slash charts.
It's an easy area to blame, say, what the town's mismanaged.
Right, yeah. I was just going to say that the one major piece of feedback I got from the financial forum was that people thought the money wasn't spent appropriately to begin with. And I think it goes to your point, Bob, that, you know, this is normal course, what's happening with an override. It has nothing to do with good or bad decisions. If anything, they were good decisions made, and that's why we've gone as long as we have. But in particular, people have brought up the library. And whether that's, you know, that's not necessarily my opinion, but I'm sort of just bringing it out as maybe something that needs to be specifically addressed in how that didn't necessarily affect where we are today. So I just have heard that.
Or that we knew it was going to, I mean.
Or that's true, yeah. It was a calculated.
Right.
Yes.
I mean, you didn't have people's attention, but. How much were we saying at town meeting and everything else? You understand, we've got other issues coming down the road. But bottom line is a town vote, and that was what the town chose.
Right.
Every citizen chose that, so.
But the notion that they're going to punish
the town. It wasn't every citizen, it was 28% turnout.
Yeah, but you know what I mean. It was the option
exactly.
of every
not
citizen
all
to chime in.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think the other options for raising sustainable revenue, I don't know if that was where we had been asked to provide what the town had already done or what the town had already considered for raising revenue short of an override. And I think that could be useful to see what's already been done.
I think that's great to do already, and then even the potential additional sources.
Yes.
In other words, what other ways are being considered?
Mm-hmm.
And let's say they all were enacted.
Mm-hmm.
How much of an impact would that have?
Yes.
Yeah, I think
right,
it's got to be a little bit more
have
than
that list.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
For the towns that we do compare ourselves to, in the nice chart regarding taxes, property taxes, nice one. How many of them have had overrides and with what frequency?
I'm not sure. I really don't.
So there is that data.
I know.
It is available. I can show you exactly where it is on the website.
It might,
but that might be worth playing with.
On what website?
DOR.
Has all, as all overrides.
Anything that's come to vote.
Right, and I think so, and I think it shows.
You go by date, I thought was easier, actually. You look at dates, and then it'll give you by community, the amount, and what it was for.
Does it show attempts, yes, no?
Right, just.
Yeah, there's a vote, every single one.
Add a column.
Trouble is.
For the taxes and say.
Yeah.
A lot of communities do small amounts. And the way DOR classifies it, it's either debt exclusion or it's an override. And so if you're asking for $50,000 for a truck, it's called an override.
Can you see what it was?
Yes.
You can see the amount, so you can sort of figure it out.
Oh, say that again, if you ask.
The DOR calls capital exclusions overrides.
Oh.
Bill, you should get on that.
Yeah, you sure should.
Because they only know debt exclusion or override.
A lot of communities will throw four on the ballot every single year.
Because I did calculations, I don't know if I showed you, the average override is something like, you know, $579,000. It's like, what?
Yeah.
Twenties and fifties, let's have an override.
Yeah, the website actually lets you call out, not just the, if it's exclusion versus override, capital, by size, by community, each thing. So you can, there's data to play with and to kind of see what it was.
Yeah, I'll see if I have that, because I may have made a list of our peer communities through DRR's website to do that. I'll see, I don't remember.
Because that could be a powerful chart as well, especially if we're talking about the perception of whether it's a spending issue versus just a standard issue that, or a unique issue that the town is facing. We can say, well, actually, this is what our peer community has done. Or peer communities have done, by comparison.
Okay.
So on that note, my question on that was, how often do we assess
the need for it?
No, do an actual assessment of properties?
Yeah, 3 years.
Right.
Do you need override if you do assess more?
You can only grow at 2.5% regardless of how it's assessed.
Is that right?
Right.
Yeah.
You could double the assessment, but that then your rate has to come down. So new growth, improvements.
That's all new growth. So it's
that's
just
all new growth.
Growth.
Yeah, that's.
It's the only thing that's exempt from 2.5.
And just as, and that was interesting to hear at Financial Forum, the whole commercial tax rate discussion.
Yeah.
That can't change the piece of the pie. It can't change
right.
The pie. I didn't realize that.
I didn't either.
Besides, I understand math wise that for me to save $50, I'm putting thousands on that.
Right.
You know. So that math mm-hmm. alone needs to be presented because it's not.
Yeah.
I remember going to one of the selectmen's meetings years ago about this discussion that made me understand that. But what I didn't realize, that piece, the pie can't change.
None of us thought of that until the person said, oh, no, you've answered my question. You can't grow the pie. We're like, oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oops.
Yeah.
So it doesn't
oops.
Solve the revenue problem.
Right. I can understand the community being upset with the selectmen if it could
mm-hmm.
raise revenue.
Right. Right, and
sorry,
why haven't we done it? I think on point six, I think the town and the school committees have given answers to those numbers. I think that's you know, that's now information
yes.
that's out there, so that's great. We can talk through eight, and we should have a discussion on eight, and probably the selectmen can provide the most information on that one would be my suggestion. Number eight being the other options. You know, we've talked about some different things. They've evaluated some different things.
It's not a lot of meaningful ones. You could talk about a trash fee, $1.5 million. Did I just get a knife in my back?
Yes, you did.
I'd say daggers, plural.
Did you feel a spit?
After the town elections, they tried it and failed.
I know.
Yeah, but
just throwing ideas.
Yeah,
there.
I think it, you know, people. It's critical that people understand that kind of you know everything is discussed and reviewed. See what's possible and what's not.
How long? Where are we in the contract with our? Didn't we just get a new contract?
We've put an RFP out on the street right now, so we should know in 6 or 8 weeks.
So in the middle of the budget cycle.
Yeah, we think we've budgeted a little high. We'll see. I don't know. Yeah, exactly.
Great.
The only other thing that I You know, I don't even know how you do it at this stage, but the possible consequences, I think that's sort of the other side of the coin on this, right? We're talking about sort of facts that bolster why we need it. But the other piece I've heard time and time again is, well, what if we don't? Like, what happens?
Right.
And I don't even know if we could answer that question at this point, because I think some of the selectmen potentially would need to do work to figure out kind of what kind of override would be required, I would assume. And then based on that, you would have to figure out, okay, what can sort of calculate through that. But that's the only other piece I feel like we haven't addressed, but I'm not even sure we can.
I think we can lay out, and actually Bob did in the chart, you know, what's the likely change in the budget going forward if we stay within all of our current revenues? And, okay, and the number that we've been batting around is about 1%.
That was in the school committee's presentation.
I think it's in all the presentations, because that's kind of what it looks like. That's what we've been discussing the last few years. So the question of what does that mean, I think, again, the town and the schools can address what that means.
I agree as well. I mean, I think it's been made clear that it would not be a level service budget, that there would be cuts in services as a result of that, but we couldn't say what they would be. We have no basis for that.
Right. No, I know.
So level service has been 3.5 to 3.75% roughly. That's the notion. So a 1 is dramatically less. So it's cuts in services. What cuts in services take place? You know, the town and the schools are going to figure out what has the least impact, right? But it's, you know, a cut of a few percent on a $90 million budget. So, you know, it's millions of dollars.
I'm trying to see what bullet that wasn't. Because sometimes people would hear, well, if we've got 3.25% increase, there's a disconnect. Why is that? Why does that get us to cutting? And I think that's when we have the discussion about some of the accommodated cost, that we see more of that. I think that gets me so telling, because it's not obvious to someone to say, 3.25%? Yeah, sounds fine. What's the big deal?
Yeah.
And 3.25% gets eaten up.
So in some sense, there are kind of two categories of things. There's kind of budget stuff, if you will, and impacts on things we've talked about here, revenue and spending. The other chart that I think would be very helpful is my tax bill. And how much of it is kind of the base tax? How much of it relates to the school projects? How much of it relates to library projects? And the point of the separation is that some of those expire. Some don't, some do. And I think everybody needs to see what that is. And I think that the reality of what's happened in the last couple of months, everybody saw their tax bill and they saw a change that wasn't, you know, just 2.5%.
I've been hearing quite a bit of grumbling.
I'm glad they haven't come to me.
But, you know, again, people voted for it.
That's sort of the way we've shown it in the past. Maybe it's too vague.
When you say you show someone's tax bill, what do you mean?
Well, here's actually an
average tax bill.
Tax bill.
Average tax bill. Okay.
No, we want to show Mark's.
I want to show the our new neighbor coming across the street in that house. That's going to be that's a new tax bill that's coming.
Every tax bill.
You may want to sit on this side, Bob.
That was an average tax bill.
Okay.
But if you look at all of our revenues, that brings along other revenues, state aid, other local revenues, so that the average single-family home paying $6,800, there was actually $9,600 of revenue for that family. Mm-hmm. And then on the next page, here's how they spent it.
Okay.
So, you know, but it's kind of vague.
Yeah, I think really having a piece that says, okay, out of that 8547, you have a piece there that says,
you know, the
schools.
High school and the library projects disappearing would be helpful to see. That's
exactly.
Like $300 a year. It's not a huge amount, but it's something.
I also, I think especially because you just explained to it, I understand what this is saying, but if it could be confusing to
see
the
96-11,
and if someone, if it's not their property taxes, but it's somehow an amount assigned to them coming from other revenue sources, I think that could be a little confusing.
Yeah, we'd have to take the expenses and just pretend and scale them down
right,
to that tax.
Right, proportionally.
And just, say proportionally, here you go. Right. Initially, when we did this, someone was interested, well, tax bill's not the only, you know, it's only 60% of your revenues.
Mm-hmm.
How else do we get money?
Mm-hmm.
And I thought it was interesting that, you know, the state aid is as paltry as it is, $1,500 comes from the state for each household to support the local government. That's a real tangible number.
But if it had
and
kept
it's twice
up.
As much as other local revenues.
Yeah.
And that's getting, again, onto the impact of what we could do, you know, other than kind of a broad-based.
Yeah, that's a really interesting discussion, because I'd say the schools have done certainly a better job than we have with, you know, a variety of their user fees. But that really gets right at the philosophy of what is the government supposed to do. So just because it would be legal for us to charge a bunch more fees, is that what you really should do as a government? I've had this discussion with the library about their new building and room fees. And it's a real philosophical, it's a free
mm-hmm.
and public library.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Well, what happens when, you know, X nonprofit wants to rent it and they pay you $500? It's a free and public library. So, you know, you want to cover the cost of the janitor being there, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
But it is, you know, we're not a business. We're not supposed to turn a profit. We're not supposed to initially charge.
But we
so
have
that's
to
a
stay
real
in
discussion.
Business.
Well, we will stay in business one way or the other, though.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I think, and again, you know, each of the boards has to address it themselves, but one of the things that the library brought up is that they have new technology, they need technology assistance. And in the land of the current budget situation, I'm not sure how they would fund that.
Yeah.
But perhaps that's an important thing that other users of that building would need. And maybe that's, in addition to the janitors, they need help for technology and other things.
Well, certainly one area the school does a substantially better job is with through the PTOs, getting,
mm-hmm.
if you will, non-general fund money, not just fees, but,
mm-hmm.
you know, here, help.
Gifts.
We'll help you. I was reading the selectman's gift policy the other day, and I was trying to remember the last time they got a gift. I really don't remember. And almost, you know, not every school committee meeting, but it's frequent.
Mm-hmm.
So
the library
they do a better job.
Of the Reading Library, which actually...
Yeah, they have the Friends and the Foundation.
Quite a bit, right?
Yeah.
The
yeah, no, it's all good.
And they are the Friends donations are actually what pay for the bulk or close to all of the programming that the library
mm-hmm.
offers.
Wow.
So they actually.
The cemetery,
there's a substantial part that actually didn't.
After all, people are just dying to get
it. We collect this before they go in.
You just you get the fee before they go in?
Yeah. Believe it or not, I guess years ago people didn't pay the fee after they got married.
Is it still me?
So I'll have to get money.
There was an interesting chart that Dr. Doherty presented at the last meeting, which was beyond the budget that comes out of the general fund, how much does it take to run the schools?
Mm.
And it's millions of dollars. It's
yeah.
a very substantial number. I forget exactly, but it's somewhere between $3 and $6 million.
I can think $5 million off the top of my head.
Yeah, it's a big number. And so, you know, in terms of, you know,
yeah,
a question
it's a lot
about
of federal grants they have.
It's grants, it's user fees, it's a variety of different things that are required to keep the place running.
And we just don't have that. We have $800,000 of recreation revolving fund for expenses. That's a real number.
Right.
Maybe we could, you know, get together another couple $100,000 to go over $1 million, but that's all.
Have we figured out how the Boston Public Library is able to charge so much?
It's not a public library. It's a 401(c).
Ooh. And they trademarked their name because they're called the Boston Public Library.
That's other libraries have done the same.
Mm.
Oh my goodness.
Wow.
Huh. Interesting.
Yeah. I think I first noticed that in Connecticut. I didn't understand why, then I understood why.
Because the fees that they charge.
They can charge any fee then, whatever the market will bear.
They offer wedding packages and
right.
catering and a variety of other things, which I don't think are on the plate.
So, you know, we haven't, you know, when you say we've exhausted every possibility, I think that's true on the cost side, as much as I can think of, but it's not necessarily true on the revenue side. You know, an override
weddings
is an easy
the
answer.
Weddings
at the library. If it reorganizes as a 501(c).
you know, have we really taken the same level of effort on the revenue side? There's no way.
Right.
But it's our basic assumption that that's not, the town doesn't have an appetite for those kinds of things. To, you know, say, well, it's not really a public library anymore, it's owned by a nonprofit, things like that. It's not to say we're right in thinking that, though. I don't know. You know, whether that's part of the discussion in the next year or two, I suppose it could be.
I think certainly the library board needs to have that philosophical discussion.
They feel very strongly against anything along those lines. I've talked to them, and I'm not saying I disagree with them.
Yeah, no, we heard from them at the last selectmen's meeting, in fact.
Bob, I think at the when we had the financial forum, there's been a line item on the budget for, forgive me, I don't remember the exact name, some sort of economic development manager.
Planner, yeah.
Planner that we weren't able to fund due to the current condition of the budget. One of the items highlighted here in item 10, long-term town plans, and I don't know the answer to this, but is it prudent to not fill or fund that position, given what we're saying that we have not maximized our efforts on the revenue front? I mean, obviously that's a long-term investment, it won't have immediate turnaround, but.
Yeah, just to give a very small backstory, two and a half years ago, I sat with the then Economic Development Committee and said, you know, here's $600,000-$700,000. What's the best way to use it to promote economic development? And honestly, I just never got an answer from them. You'll be glad to know the selectmen beat me about the head at the last meeting, and the planner's in the budget.
That was
the
discussion.
What
and
we've exactly
the source
done
of funds.
Is put $125,000 in and then offset by $125,000 in the inspection revolving fund. So it doesn't cost the general fund anything. And the $125,000 is undoubtedly too much, but that's the most we could spend because town meeting authorized $200,000 a year and we're already spending $75,000. So I said, as a placeholder, what's the difference? It's going to net out. Let's just put more plus and minus $125,000 and then we'll figure it out.
I don't fully understand that. The, you know, putting it in, but using the revolving fund offset. And
so the inspections revolving fund, as in round numbers, has $700,000 in. I don't remember exactly. That's about right, though. If we're using about $75,000 a year, 10 years at that rate, you're done. Then you're then you have to find another way to pay for what you were doing.
So what's it currently being used?
To offset community services side of public services costs, extra building inspectors hours, mm-hmm. a lot of document storage, scanning over time. Those are really the two things I can think of. I think maybe also overtime for minutes in meetings, which you know, may or may not really be sensible.
So which fees were going into that?
Went in past tense, three big projects.
Right, so there were specific projects. It's not the everyday.
No, and there's an article at every town meeting that explains what the revolving fund is and what you can use it for. The town manager theoretically has the authority to use it for a list of things that are related, but then town meeting by vote can do anything they want with it as long as it's lawful. So last spring, when I had given up on EDC coming up with ideas, we used over $100,000 of it to balance the snow and ice deficit. May as well start using it. It's money. Why is it sitting here? But certainly a much better use is to make an investment for a position like this. And we figure we can easily fund it for 3 years and maybe 4 years and still do all the other things.
Okay.
But then after 4 years, we have to stop all of that. We have to find alternative funding sources if we want to keep doing it.
Or an idea is going to bring in.
Or you hope that that person has now created regeneration of funds based on economic growth.
But that wouldn't necessarily go into the revolving fund.
Wouldn't necessarily, but
it wouldn't probably at all. It would just go into the general tax.
Right. But so that's the great point. It's not a traditional revolving fund where the balance has to go to zero year end.
Correct.
It's a limited life fund.
It's
so
much more
end of
like
the year,
school revolving funds that don't have that.
Yeah, they maintain a balance at, over time. The notion here is that it will decline over time. But it's not as if at year end that money would have gone back into the general fund by itself and we're just kind of stealing from one pocket and putting it in the other. It's
that's
no money.
The sale of real estate fund.
Right.
Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's probably worth us going through kind of each
of
those.
That one's down to about $600,000, more or less. And none of it's earmarked for anything at this point. the landfill sale was earmarked to pay for capital, and that's now done.
Right.
So this is from the sale of two single-family lots within the last 3 years by the selectmen. And that's not, that's meant to sit there and wait.
Right, and that was one of the things we all talked about as a revenue source, was to see what property was around
right.
in town that could be sold.
Bill can probably tell you one of them.
Yeah.
Oak Road. Next year will be 80 years since the tax rolls.
So there's no new funds going into that?
No.
That.
No, if a new project come in, you know, for the 40B going down by the depot, should we consider putting that in there? I guess we could consider it. You know, the reason that that fund was set up is to pay for one-time unexpected costs.
Mm-hmm.
But everyone kind of knew the fees going in were going to well exceed those one-time unexpected costs. And to just go back a step to the landfill development, I remember this discussion when I was in your shoes on FinCom. Not enough thought was given to what are the new costs that this project's bringing to town, as opposed to, oh, look at all the revenue. So, you know, in that particular case, that brought little to no school costs, but a fair amount of public safety costs. And nothing was really ever explicitly done to take care of that. You know, we eventually figured it out and worked it out with the schools and hired a couple of police officers. But when you have these new sources of revenue, you really want to think long and hard about what are the costs, not just see the revenue. Because it's often not easy to see. It's often fire, EMS. You know, you have over 55 housing, that's going to be a pretty high demand. You know, police in certain instances, and then school kids are the more obvious one.
Mm-hmm. And most expensive.
So that, you know, we'll be glad to see there is that investment being made, and I agree with it. And you know, we'll see in 3 years, we'll know it. We'll probably know in a year.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot going on in this town that someone can be very busy with. In the middle of the snowstorm Friday, we met with a really large developer with some interesting ideas. But it's just so hard to follow through in a lot of this. That's almost really a job by itself.
It is.
Yeah.
Agreed.
Agreed. Yeah. And you can't get tempted and let that person do anything else because
exactly.
you lose the total focus.
Right.
Yeah.
Any other comments on this, guys? Any comments from other folks? No. How do we take this forward? What are we going to do with it now?
Let me tell you a little about what the selectmen are doing.
Sure.
Just so you have that. I don't know what the school committee's up to. Well, most of us are still looking at the FY17 budget, but. The next two selectmen's meetings, they're both, one's the end of February, one's early March. There's about an hour set aside at the very end of the meeting to discuss financial situation. So what I'm tasked to do in the next 2 weeks is create a menu of choices, including timelines, for all kinds of things. There'll be some sort of community meetings, community communication. Whether it be selecting by themselves, jointly with the school committee, or in some format. And then looking at, if you want to have an override, when's the best election? You know, what are the pluses and minuses for combining with certain elections? We know we're not going to have the November presidential election. But technically we could, I'll use the word combine, I don't think that's legally right, but we could hold it the same day as the September primary, which is a Thursday. And have two separate ballots and have more election workers, so it's a little cheaper.
Thursday, that's interesting.
Yeah,
I never knew.
It's the Thursday after the long weekend,
huh.
Instead of the Tuesday after the long weekend.
Mm-hmm.
Don't ask me why. But if that's going to be an option, and that's probably the cheapest option if you want to do that, then there's the question to wrestle with: do you want a special town meeting in advance of that? You don't have to have one, but typically Reading does it that way. And you have to then back up. You know, with elections and town meetings, all the different schedules, and we don't have a lot of time. The town clerk needs to know, I'm not sure, it's either 4 or 6 weeks in advance of an election. And then if town meeting has to be in front of that 4 to 6 week time frame, it also needs 2 weeks for, you know, someone to contest a vote of town meeting. So you're talking about, you know, some kind of a time frame so the selectmen have some idea. And by no means does an override have to appear in an election that's already scheduled, you know, whether it's next April, whether it's one of these other ones, it can be by itself. It's not the end of the world. But they just need to see their options and the timeframes. Because obviously the most important part of this is information needs to go to the community in a digestible form. And honestly, the selectmen have to decide whether they want to have one. I mean, they're willing to have a discussion, mm-hmm. but you know whether they're really willing to have one or not has not been decided.
And if so, to cover what?
Right, how much and why?
Yeah.
Right.
What's the philosophy behind it? Is it a 5-year one? Is it a 15-year one? Big difference.
Yep. That's, at this point, I think that is the gating factor, though, right?
Yeah. I guess, yeah. I haven't had that discussion with any of them, quite honestly. I mean, I can tell you if you want to not have one for another 10 years, I can tell you how much you should have.
When you say a 5-year one or a 15-year one, I thought an override was
when I say that, permanent. I mean sufficient for not asking for another one for five
Got
years.
It. Thank you.
Yeah.
And does it just encompass general fund kinds of things or capital projects or
right.
what?
But you can also choose to do one, and you can speak to this better, that let's say you want to last 10 years. You can choose to not use as much of it up front, right?
Well, I'll just give you a real simple example. You could do a $9 million override, which is about 15%. And that's about the last two overrides that Reading has done is about 15%. But you could only assess $6 million for the first 10 years. And you could argue that there's another $3 million out there people are paying for the library and the high school.
Mm-hmm.
And what that does is after 10 years, there's another $3 million available for the general fund that could be levied without another override. So that's just one possibility.
So people's tax bill would remain constant.
Correct. Well, go up 2.5%.
Right.
Well, it wouldn't look different
right.
after the...
The slope would remain the same.
After the... Exactly. Once the...
that's right.
Once the library expired. Okay.
So there's a bunch of philosophical questions, you know, not to get too far afield, but they've talked in the past about taking a lot of the water debt and putting it on the tax rate. Join the MWRA, we're going to be paying that off for 10 or more years. That could be deductible if you would bring it out of the water fund into the tax levy. That's very complicated, but Winchester did it. So there's a bunch of possible options, and you don't want it to be too confusing.
Right.
What I think the selectmen did say at the financial forum was that they thought their time frame would in fact be March to kind of be able to come back with some specifics, if you will.
Okay. Yeah.
So I think that's you know that's the time frame. I think that's great to have it you know in advance of town meeting, and I think you know whatever information we're putting together probably should, you know, the notion of that time frame probably makes sense for us too. So everything kind of is together in that March time frame and pre-town meeting.
Do you have the dates of those selectmen's meetings? That
September 20th.
It would be March 8th and 22nd.
March 8th and 22nd.
Oh, isn't yeah. it? Isn't there one?
There's one in February 23rd. Also, 23rd. Those are the next three.
March 8th. What was that to March 8th?
February 23rd and March 8th. This is an agenda item. 22nd, I don't remember. I don't think it is yet. But again, it's, you know, it's a 10 o'clock, 1 hour discussion. It could go in any direction. I just don't know yet. Depends how the rest of the night has gone, frankly.
But the conversation is slated for to start at 10?
9:30, 10.
Yeah.
It's the last one.
Yeah.
And depending on how complicated prior things are,
mm-hmm.
It's hard to predict.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not meant to solve anything in those two. Those are just two discussion points.
Mm-hmm.
Where then, you know, there's five of them, and there may be five opinions. They're just going to lay them all out on the table and start talking about it in public.
And are you planning to have the array, the menu of options for the
next I probably
next
will.
Meeting?
I should, hopefully. Depends on the FY17 budget, how that progresses.
Okay.
I would like to do that, though. And I know most of those answers.
So just a commentary on that. As individuals, if you have a strong feeling about those activities, it probably is worth sharing that with the selectmen. So that they hear it in advance of those meetings. And
but not
part
as members of them.
as individuals. So we're back to this point. How do we take this forward? So we've whittled it down to some things. I think probably we need to take each of those items and kind of have someone drill into it and put together, let's call it an exhibit, and then take a look at it again.
You should last time set some PowerPoint or...
Yeah, I think eventually it'll format to PowerPoint. Well, actually, I think on the website we have the option, it could be slides, right?
Yeah,
format ones, it could be anything we need.
Normally on a website we'd like to put PDFs, but you make them out of any software.
So. Right, so PPTs can be done in PDF form,
yeah.
But...
Mac Bill.
Yep.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Bill.
We can still disagree, right?
Absolutely.
You can good luck in your badge.
I like your jacket. Looks like you got a new Christmas gift.
So I think my suggestion is that we need kind of a champion to take each one of the points, each core point, and work on it and kind of take it to the next level. And if it's...
I'll take one that needs to steal Bob's choice.
It would be three then.
Yeah, I think three is a good one that way. Thank you.
I had a comment on the free cash description. In the third paragraph, where we talk about what it is and that it's currently 9% of the budget, in the past we've talked about how certain projects have been delayed or postponed, and yet they were projects that were slated to be pulled from free cash. I don't know if it's worth mentioning that, saying, okay, it's currently stands at 9%, however, X amount is actually slated for projects pending in, you know, the remainder of 2016 or moving forward in 2017. So in reality, it's more accurate to say X percent, 7% versus 9%. I don't know if that matters or not, but I know it's something we discussed previously.
Care to hazard a guess on delayed projects impact?
Not very much.
Yeah.
More in the enterprise funds, actually.
Yeah.
They may have been allocated elsewhere since then.
Yeah, sewer was a big impact.
Remember, too, we've recommended lower capital spending, the last couple of years.
Right.
So, you know, that's either more to the general fund or
it's been about
less
half
cash.
A million total between the 2 years.
Yeah, I think this can't live as four paragraphs at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. I mean, this was just kind of a first kind of blah. Here's kind of what probably has to be there somehow. And there was a suggestion to compare it with other communities, which I think you did, Bob, in fact. I think that's great, too, so that people see it's not like we're sitting on this tremendous amount of money that, oh my God, we don't know what to do with it. How can we spend it?
Are you going to include that graph?
I think we should.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I think we just want to keep things simple. I think of it as a savings account that, I mean, I don't think...
The state calls it a rainy day fund. It's not a bad name.
Yeah,
rainy
day fund. And that's exactly how we do use it.
Rename our stabilization.
I think the harder thing to explain to people who aren't with it all the time is the idea of regeneration. So I think you want to give examples. Oh, and when you give examples, I go, oh, okay, I can relate to that, I get that. But using the word regeneration is not...
One thing FinCom could do, and we've discussed it here and there in the past, is we have a stabilization fund that has like $1.5 million in it for no reason that I know of. Call it that, call it something else, park a whole lot more money in there and say that's our 5%.
That's what I said.
And then it disappears. It's not called free cash anymore.
Right.
Then your real free cash is really what's
right.
above free
and
cash.
And we should be comfortable knowing that it's a different rule for getting out the 2/3, but
so on.
It should be.
Yeah.
Yeah. I actually have paid for it.
Then, you know, you'd have to be a little careful because you may not want to put 5% in there, but whatever. There's
some number
that you could put in there. Because my guess is if you only had,
what's the
$9 million. Right now you might have $4 million not in there. Would you really use $2 million to balance a budget out of 4 as opposed to 2 out of 9? No, you wouldn't.
So
Say it again?
Well, it's a philosophical change, knowing that 5 million, the 5% is already put in, you know.
Right, so.
Let's say we have 9 million right now, and I'm guessing in cash. If you parked 5 million in this fund and called it a rainy day fund and it disappeared, but you knew it was there, and you only had four.
What do you mean it disappeared?
Well, it's off to the side.
Put it in stabilization fund, which takes two-thirds majority, not 50%.
It's restricted, basically.
Take money out of it.
Okay.
And you only had 4 million not there, would you be willing to say, yeah, let's use 2 million to balance next year's budget out of that 4 million that's easily available? Psychologically, I don't see it. Maybe you would, if you get real comfortable that this 5 million is there for unexpected reasons.
It's an education, and I think you'd have to get more comfortable. Because if you make it something different than the 5%, it starts to not have any basis.
I would agree.
I think that a couple of issues. One is that if it goes into a restricted fund, it may require, if we need it for something else, a higher town meeting vote to release it. That's, I think, the core difference between how we categorize it.
The only difference is our stabilization fund can be used for any purpose. There are things like real estate that is limited in its purpose, but it just does need the two-thirds vote as opposed to the majority vote, which, honestly, that's of no consequence in writing. I think if that's really the difference on an issue, why are we doing it?
Right. We should be able to get two-thirds.
Right.
Yeah.
Just to make sure I understand the terminology, we're on the same page. When you say restricted fund, you mean restricted account, not a money market fund or mutual fund?
Right. No.
Okay.
But I'm actually thinking more that if it is allocated for certain purposes only, you can only spend it on certain things if that's the case.
Okay. Which?
Like sale of real estate kinds of things. The other thing I think we've got to do is, for our own purposes, we need to talk about net free cash. So we talked about spending 2 million in free cash to balance the budget. The net free cash that we use in the last several years has been negative, if you will, right? The free cash balance has gone up.
Yeah, most of the years it's gone up.
Right. So
despite your best efforts.
Right. So we try to spend it and we just can't.
Right. So you definitely have a good chart on that.
Well, that shows free cash. And I think someone pointed out you need to show, it was Ben actually who said you need to show
net
use. What's the real net use?
Exactly.
We allocated up to 2 million.
Right.
And then the net free cash turns out to be negative a couple hundred grand.
Right, because I thought you did have a chart on that.
I don't remember.
Not this year.
No, Sharon's done that and Gail before her, certainly. Yeah, net use of free cash plus regeneration.
Right.
Right. Well, actually, it's the regeneration that's kind of changing its direction. But this year we have been slightly less conservative, right, in terms of regeneration. We've
I don't know,
moved more to the trend.
It's impossible. I gave up trying to guess that stuff. Just when I thought the answer to that was yes, I just found out we just collected or we billed $300,000 more in excise taxes than
really
the prior year. So
great. Keep buying new cars, guys. That's the best.
Exactly. I don't know.
We got it this year, so.
I'd be happy to play with this free cash one.
Yeah, and if you wish you could pick a right graphically our number one showing, right, what we expect to pay and then we generate from the net. And you'll put me next to three. I think it was five that I liked.
Yeah, I put you
on. Oh, sorry.
And instead of Prop 2.5, I think we call it something like financial challenges or something.
Yep.
Oh, and can you send each of us your presentation? Because I don't think we have that.
Sure.
I
made a shorter one to FinCom and a longer one to the Selectmen, so I'll send them both. There's not a huge difference, but there's more detail in one of them.
Page
12.
Before free cash?
12.
I was looking at 12 only because that's got highlighted. Mm-hmm. That was kind of the narrowed list.
The ones. Mark, you're doing number two.
I got number two, yep. So number three, average tax bill by community.
That's just a copy of the copy and paste.
Vanessa, do you want to try that one? You
were expressing I was going to say I'll take 8.
I'll put Mark down for 3.
Okay. 8.
You seem eager.
That's right.
Got it.
Whatever it takes. I can do 3. I mean, I'll reach out to Bob. I need some help on that. But or did you say 1?
Yeah, it's fine.
You're doing 8.
Okay.
You do 3.
Do you know? Because I don't know, and I wouldn't know where to get the information about what we've already, all of the options that the town has already pursued.
Yeah, I don't know. I'd have to send out a lot of emails.
I was gonna
when you say pursue.
Bob. You're Bob. That's it.
Well, we got that.
There you go.
Right. It's getting a little dusty now. But,
yeah. It's starting to look
oh, yeah. That I still have.
But it gives you
it
ideas.
Wasn't a lot, though. That was mostly one time.
It was mostly one time.
Right.
Other than the credit card thing.
Right.
The electronic
yeah, we never
billboards.
Did that.
Well,
yeah.
You know.
Careful.
I know.
You know, back to the discussion of everything has to be brought
but
up.
But I think, to me, the value is to realize. We're willing to discuss everything, even if everyone yells about somebody else.
I think, again, our role is, it isn't a function of yelling. Our role is a function of what is, you know, reasonable financial policy. What are the
right.
possibilities?
Right.
So, you know, people will take opinions. That's great. Mm-hmm. But we need to bring them up.
Well, sometime you're going to get into a values discussion. You know, why isn't there a lifestyle mall in Reading? Why is it Linfield? Think of all the revenue.
That came up.
On the one hand, that's history. On the other hand, it's a valid question.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. I was surprised we didn't address it better at that financial
huge
forum.
Huge community opposition to that at the time.
We ran them out of town.
Exactly.
To put it.
Yeah. So it's easy to look back in hindsight and say, well, why didn't we do that? Well, if you were living here at the time and involved, you knew why.
So well, it never came to a vote.
The community was losing its
run them out of town?
Because the community was losing its mind that they might come here. It wasn't the best site. Linfield's a much better site.
There were some huge concerns. Yeah. It never got to the point of,
well. No. And we were hearing from every precinct, not just the precinct that lived there.
Mm-hmm.
They were certainly louder, but it was all over town. Don't do it. Going to ruin the town. Yeah,
well,
it would have changed the town, for sure.
Right. But we do have to let the community understand that
it's a choice.
It was a choice, and
right.
the choice of the town at that point was
right.
Yeah,
right. You can't go back and sort of punish the town now for the past.
Well,
best thing, because that's what I think.
And it wasn't a government decision.
No,
that,
right. Not
that
at all.
Wasn't pursued. It
well,
was community. The community's
yeah.
choice.
It really was community. The selectmen ended up agreeing with it, but you know. There'd have been a new board of selectmen if they didn't agree with it, I suspect. So.
Yeah. My suspicion was it wasn't understood that by not increasing the commercial and industrial base and leaving all of the weight on the residential base, at some point things would come home to roost. And that if you want to maintain services, you've cut off certain additional sources of revenue, then you have to find others.
But it's important information to get out there because mm-hmm. I think people point to you, Town of Reading, you government, didn't pursue this or didn't.
Well, there were three opportunities to do it. There was Johnson Woods up off West Street that could have been commercial through a concerted zoning change effort. Down at the other end of town, the old Spence Farms, which turned into apartments, and then Addison Wesley. So those are three large housing developments that
right.
could have gone another direction.
Did we get any interest?
From
you know where Johnson Woods are and where Spence Farms is.
We never really,
commercial.
To my knowledge, pursued it.
Yeah.
When was this on?
15 years ago,
okay.
ish.
Okay.
Maybe 20 in one of those cases. You know, and the fact that they're all on the same side of town, they all were housing, and they all added school kids in some way, I don't think was terribly well discussed or thought through.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't looked at as a financial decision. Put it that way.
Right.
And I'm not sure that it should have been, but you would have looked at it that way, and I would have looked at it that way.
Right, and at some point, how much control do we have on some of that stuff, right? Especially
well,
when it's 40.
Yeah,
right?
40Bs are harder, but other than that, we can, you know, we can guide, we can vote, we can cajole. I mean, certainly people push back against it. We can certainly push forward as well.
You know, Walker's Brook is the obvious place where you're just not going to see complaints about commercial development. You know, we were down at the at the light department,
the
right in the middle of the neighborhood, doing an MAPC meeting with a bunch of neighbors from Ash Street, and all of them were in favor of commercial development as long as Ash Street didn't become a raceway. As long as this Ashway is not the main way in and out of this place, we're good with all that.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it is now. You know,
mm-hmm.
And whatever you're going to do is going to make it look nicer. All the other examples were different. There were neighbors.
Do we have everything covered? I think we do. I think that the item six is Board of Selectmen and School Committee. That's their bailiwick. And number 10 probably needs to come from the selectmen too, the long-term plans.
Yeah.
And what I was planning to do was kind of share the output of this meeting with the leadership of the selectmen, so that number one, they know what we've talked about, and then let's have a discussion on what might be, you know, the right timing and what makes it the most helpful to when the information should be available.
When did you want to do that?
I mean, even if it's just conceptually, but then once we have some detail, I think it'd be great. And maybe what we can do is, we've got now, you know, today's the 10th, so we've got meetings already scheduled for all the Wednesdays of March, right? 2/9/16/23.
Yep.
So maybe what we do is we make sure that we're set by the second.
Yeah.
Or at least the next draft by the second.
Yeah. Will the locations be determined later?
Locations
of the meetings. March 2nd,
9th, 16th. I think we're all here. That's a good question, actually. What do you think? We've been in other locations. Do you think you'll see the financial forum type turnout? Because this room won't be good for that.
My suspicion is that the school one, we're going to have a lot more people than we have here today. Not even a question.
Maybe just rebook that one then. Maybe put it in a school.
Mm-hmm. Or maybe to the Coolidge Multipurpose. Oh, see if they have available.
Or Coolidge Park. Yeah. I'll look that up.
Yeah, that's probably a good idea.
And times would be
7:30.
We usually go 7:30.
Right, even for the town, this gets smaller. Or were you looking at moving them all?
I'd rather not move them.
Okay.
I have a hard time imagining that it's going to be a big attendance for the first two.
Okay.
Yeah. I think this is a good segue to page two in the second topic, which really is thinking about, okay, for the budget review meetings. So before we do dates and stuff, the one thing that I think would be very helpful is, if there are questions that committee members have about any of the budgets that they've already seen or are about to see, to get those questions now to the appropriate people, and so that we'll have answers either at the meeting or before the meeting, and we can, everybody can address it much better.
Have there been any other changes other than that planner?
Yeah, little bits here and there, not substantial. I can't think of any that is more than a couple thousand, so effectively no.
The big one was the planner. Yeah. So that was one
actually, I'll just mention one. It's being voted on right now. The trustees are deciding whether to move a technology software cost out of their budget into the town's technology budget. So
I'm sorry, say that one more time.
They have Noble Software, North of Boston Library Exchange.
Yeah.
They pay $55,000 a year for a software license. Mm-hmm. They've always wanted it in their budget because it's a library cost. We've always said, well, we moved all the other software, centralized it, so they're voting tonight whether to do that or not. And if you will, one advantage of them doing that is they don't pay the book materials tax on top of it then. I can say that, they're not here.
Hmm.
So their budget, and I've told them this for 10 years, you know, they're technically, we're over 25,000 in population now, so their requirement is 13% materials. They still want to do 15%. That's another thing they're talking about tonight. If they have 55,000 less in the budget, that obviously frees them up for doing other things with the 15% of 55,000. You know, it's almost 10 grand that they don't have to put to materials. So they're kicking around a bunch of ideas tonight. That's the only change I could say that would be sort of quote unquote significant, but it's just a reallocation.
Well, how's the population come into play?
It's just part of the materials requirement is dependent on population.
And it goes up or down?
It's a black and white cutoff at 25,000.
It goes down from 15 to 13%.
We're just over that line.
Just over 25,000. Yep. So
it goes from 15 to 13?
Yes. And that's, again, that's the requirement to stay certified. That doesn't mean it's a best practice to drop it. I'm sure they want to keep it at 15, but it's another tool they have. You know, if they're trying to fund the library position that I wasn't able to fund, I gave them ways they could start taking a whack at it by making a few changes like this, spending less on materials.
So this is time for a philosophical discussion for a moment. Or actually, it's not philosophical. It's kind of process. So Bob's gonna present us with a balanced budget, which he has to by law. So given the guidance that we provided, that created what that, kind of the bottom line number is gonna be out of the general fund revenues. So as a function of that, given what the school committee has provided, what all the other groups are gonna provide, Bob will balance it, but that may not be what the group sent to us. So, or excuse me, sent to Bob. So specifically with the schools.
Well, the schools is gonna be $150,000 less.
Right, so, or it is in the budget you'll present. But when the school committee presents to us, they're gonna present to us saying, we want the extra 150.
I'm not sure they will.
They might. How's that?
The 150 is gonna show up at April town meeting instead.
Oh, okay, well.
It's a placeholder.
Okay, so.
We'll see.
Yeah, so the schools may come in with different numbers. Right.
Well, it's a one-time, but it might, it's for 3 years, so it's.
Yeah, it's a three-time.
Yeah.
Oh, that's right.
And I don't know what public discussion.
It's the implementation of a.
Science curriculum.
Of a science curriculum. Not 3 years, yeah.
And the purpose of doing it now, I believe, is to kind of jump on it earlier.
Get it bought now.
Yeah, makes sense.
Right. So that may or may not be, well, it will be a discussion whether or not they request it in.
Yeah, I don't know.
As an addition, we don't know yet. Will the library, would a library issue potentially come up that way? It has in the past.
Well, I don't know, they've asked you for another $400,000.
Right, right. So it may come up in the presentations.
Absolutely, it may.
So there could be a discussion of that.
I'm sorry.
The library, anybody conceivably could ask us to do it. Why is this happening? The reason it's happening is because the budget that goes to town meeting for approval actually is FinCom's budget. We've given guidance to the town and to the schools in terms of what they can do based on the financial, I guess the revenue availability is probably the best way of putting it in the general fund. So based on that guidance, that creates a budget. Everybody comes in with their recommendations. It has to come out balanced at the end of the period from Bob. It comes to us. We need to vote on it. We need to vote on the different line items, basically, other than the school budget, which I think is a single number, right?
Right.
Right. So we will hear from department heads, the school committee, school department, et cetera, and Bob on what their numbers are and why. If you've been able to attend some of the meetings already, you probably have heard a good part of the presentations already before they had approved the budgets. But that's kind of what's going to happen next. And depending on how the school committee decides or board of trustees, whatever, they may ask for different things or maybe just kind of write on what's there. Our role in this is to go through, understand what's in there, and make sure that from a financial point of view, it seems to make sense. And if we have questions, we need to be asking those questions. The best way to do that is in advance of when they actually get here. If we do it when they get here, it gets bogged down, and it's harder to get good answers. So I implore everybody, to the extent that you aren't comfortable with the budgets already, get comfortable with them. And you know, Bob said, what, in a week Monday?
Depends partly what the library does tonight. If they don't do anything, it's going to be ready early next week. If they do something, I've got to change a lot of documents. And,
okay.
You know, really works that out.
Once that comes, we want to be, you know, going through it. If you have been to the meetings, or I think you can go online at this point, the school committee probably is up, the school budget.
Not sure, actually. Ours is not.
Okay.
Right, so I missed the selectmen's night when the library presented. So any...
They presented a three-year plan, well thought out through their consultant, that effectively added $400,000 in operating costs. Phased in, you know, a little bit.
So are there any other requests that we wouldn't see in the budget that would come up when we're getting... presented to.
You know, that's a good question, because I sort of treat the library the way the school budget is, bottom line. I say, you know, you spend it how you want, but here's how much you have.
Yeah.
So I have a default budget, if you will, based on what they submitted to me in November, December. Tonight they may entirely rewrite that budget based on the bottom line. That's why I don't want to answer the question. I don't know.
So none of the other budgets?
The rest are fine.
Okay.
But that one, you know, and if they're voting it tonight, I may not see it till next week. So I just don't know.
I have a question regarding the digital manager, because I know that one was a,
yeah,
a questionable one. How does it help by moving it over to the town?
That wouldn't be moved. There was a different cost that would be moved. It's a software license, nothing to do with a person.
Oh, a license, okay.
They're already paying $50,000 for the license. But just be a question of us paying a bill quarterly. Not a big deal.
I wondered if I could ask a question.
Sure, please.
From Chris. Now, a week or two ago, I did this story about the financial form. Okay, all right? And it clearly indicates no override with town administrator's budget. Now, that went up to everybody, and that sort of indicated where the form stood. Okay? Was a long article. It was almost, you know, as articles go in this paper, extended all the way to the second page. Okay? Now, I have this, came to the meeting to cover this, and they assigned me the finances and the selectmen, and then the finance committee. Now, I'm trying to, this is a very well done thing. What is its objective? To change this? Is that what I'm to write for tomorrow?
That's a really interesting question, actually. I believe I'll speak for the selectmen's intention that if they want to discuss an override, it's for FY18 and not sooner.
Excuse me?
So we're discussing the fiscal 2017 budget.
Right.
That starts July 1st.
Right.
If there's going to be an override discussion, it will not change that budget.
So
it's for the future.
So fiscal year
18, right.
Well, that's important.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good question.
Right, because sometimes the timing seems funny.
Because if it happens in the fall,
for 17,
in the middle of the fiscal year.
Right.
Right.
What I just said here.
Yeah,
right.
What you said there was accurate.
This is really talking future.
Yeah.
But I think what that also implies is that fiscal year 17, you know, per the discussion we had at the financial forum, the likelihood of that budget could be about a 1% increase, which on net
for 18.
Yeah.
Well, I tried to present in the article all the difficulties you were going through trying to bring that budget into balance. And so,
yeah,
you know,
that's a fair question.
Yeah, no, it's right on the line.
So if it wasn't, and I'll write an article tomorrow that will be pretty consistent with that, but say, here are some things that the town is looking for.
You guys also
in the future.
Yeah.
Yeah. And looking at
right.
Fiscal year 18.
Right. And I think the other piece of that is that the planning process for the budget is far in advance of the budget taking place, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, the budgets that are being presented and that we'll review in March, what FinCom will review in March, are for the coming fiscal year,
yeah,
which
right.
will start July.
Fiscal year 17.
Right. But we give guidance, we FinCom give guidance in October for the following fiscal year.
Yeah.
So if things are the same from a revenue point of view, when we get to October of this year,
yeah.
The budget guidance that we will give will be based on existing revenues.
Right.
And the best guess as to what that would be at this point is
but I can indicate cuts. Basically, this is what you're looking at tonight, where you're going in fiscal year 18.
I think that would be fair.
Yeah.
Or else your houses will all be rushed.
Again, or more.
Especially since we all smiled in the picture.
I know, we should have gone through it.
We'd only know.
We said, we're going to do a do-over.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the point of this discussion, the point of the Board of Selectmen meeting, the point of the school committee getting together is they're looking at what's the likelihood of future budgets.
Yeah.
And they need to understand what they are and the implications, and if they need to have a discussion with the town, now's a good time to start the discussion.
Okay.
And that's where this list comes up.
I'll try to represent that in my article.
Thank you. So
thank you for the coverage.
Yeah, no, much appreciated. So kind of closing the loop on kind of our process. So we will go through, you know, each of the budgets, you know, normally line by line. Hopefully we've already done it and we've asked questions, we're getting answers, we're kind of just making sure of an understanding. You're going to hear from department heads on, you know, yes, but I wanted X, but I'm fine with Y, you know, to a large extent, I think. And then we just kind of go through and see if there are any kind of things that just don't fit, that just don't seem to be in the interest or problematic. And we're able to offer, to basically amend as a committee. Thanks, Eric. to kind of take a vote, and then what we then recommend is what goes to town meeting as our budget. And again, we're making recommendations. Town meeting is the one that decides where it's going to go. But you know, nominally, this is a group of 9 people that have had a chance to go through it quite a bit of depth. We're separated from the town. We're separated from the schools. So you know, people at least hear it because we present it, and then the discussion starts from there.
Do you all have the school committee's budget electronically or otherwise?
Yes.
I think you sent the approved.
I think I did.
I think you did.
I think it was 3. Was that the one we got in pieces?
No.
The town
one came in pieces. That came in 2 pieces.
If it's helpful for you, I can scan into one piece the draft town budget Friday and send it out.
Please.
It may not, and I'll try to make my best update for you about what's going on with the library.
Be great.
And you'll see some of the front pieces are not complete yet. I was working on them today.
When we vote on March 23rd, we're going to have some more information about some of the assumptions we made in providing guidance. We should know where the health insurance.
You know, if the longer I wait not to give you a budget, I may know.
Yeah.
And I may be able to adjust it, but I don't know if I'll be able to.
But we should, by the time we vote, we should know. So when we're
considering
any requests above and beyond our guided budgets, then we should have that information. And we maybe we'll have some direction from the legislature if they're planning to do anything different than the governor on local aid. Sometimes they do a local aid resolution.
Yeah.
As long as it goes up.
Yeah.
And our actual vote is until the 23rd of March. So we're going through these, we're asking questions, we're making sure that we have, you know, we understand everything that's in there. And then on the 23rd, kind of en masse, we go through the budget and then any town meeting articles that are going to come up.
You think Bob will have the health insurance information by the beginning of March?
Oh, yeah. We usually get it around Valentine's Day.
Okay. All right.
Well, the good
maybe
news
next
is,
week.
Yeah, I mean, right
and
now.
We know the range, and the upside of the range is above 8% for sure, and I assume we're going to be there, but I don't know that. You know, it could cost another couple hundred thousand of free cash. You know, and I won't say this during March, but I'll say it now. No one's here. Be really careful spending money, because it's going to be all cut next year without an override, period.
Right.
I've told every town department, and I've sat down with the trustees, and I said, if the future looks as it does now, you will receive less money next year, period.
Yeah.
So be real careful about adding a new position or anything, unless you're also willing to keep it and then cut something else. And all of our town departments certainly know that.
Next year being 18. Say. Yeah.
Right.
Next year being 18.
Next year being 18.
Do you have an idea of the order of operations? Who's going to come in on the 2nd versus the 9th?
No, not yet.
Okay.
I usually just ask everyone with boards and committees. And this year, only the trustees will probably have an interest in coming in. The public services boards all seem somewhat content, which is nice. Board of assessors don't feel obliged to come in. They're happy. Other years, they've come in. So, no, generally, it's a content group of volunteers.
Okay.
And I think the library wanted the 2nd week. I'll get you a list.
Okay. But the schedule is on page 2. So the 2nd and the 9th are town, so just broken in half, and then the 16th will be the schools.
And I can send you a draft warrant this Friday also. Well, some of the financial stuff's guesswork for this current year's budget. Snow and ice, I have no idea. I'll give you that early March.
Yeah,
well,
see where
we
are.
To vote.
See where we are. The one thing I would ask that we ask every year of Greg is his overtime analysis, the staffing versus overtime.
Yeah, you're not the only one asked.
Right. So that's a good one to have in advance. And I don't know if it's an issue as much.
The last thing he said to me was, I cannot guarantee you, and he's pretty conservative, that if you, let's just pick a number, cut the overtime by $65,000, hire another $65,000 firefighter, that's going to save me money. That's the last thing he said.
Well, I mean, if that's where he is and he's done the analysis, things are good.
You know, as far as where the meter goes, he's getting closer, certainly.
Yeah.
You know, a year ago it might have been, well, you know, 35,000 I think will be a safe assumption for getting back. And now he's maybe 45.
or 50. So it creeps up.
Yeah, the backdrop on this is that the overtime budget, to have appropriate staffing, particularly in the fire department, it's set up in teams or squads. I forget the exact term that it uses. So if you lose a person to disability or illness or whatever that's going on, vacation, yeah. So you got to kind of fill that slot. And the if you just look at the absolute number, it's huge. It's tremendous. It's a percentage of the total that's very, very high. So we've asked each year for the chief to do an analysis of what would happen if you brought in one or frankly two more people. Because the budget's so high, it's you know, it looks like you could put in five people.
Because you're paying overtime hours.
It's overtime, and it's high, predictable.
It's still below peer community averages, I need
yes,
to
it is below peer community averages. But that said, maybe it could be better. So we keep kind of asking for the analysis of you know, what would happen if you added one or two or whatever more people. Usually when we say one, it doesn't work, but two. And that's the analysis that he kind of does and compares. So his response to that's a good one, to just understand where we are. It hasn't been as big for police.
And is that number of people you need as part of that squad at a given time, is that part of that community support, what's that called, mutual?
No, it technically has nothing to do with mutual aid.
Mutual aid.
There's something by collective bargaining and common sense called minimum manning. You know, X piece of equipment needs Y number of employees on it. It's not safe to have less.
I see.
The groups that he has have more staff than what the minimum manning would be. So if one is out, it's okay. If two is out, it's generally okay. But if more than that's out, it's not okay. So if there are, you know, long-term disabilities which they've had, if there's vacations, if there's sick time, if there's training, you know, that's when you start causing overtime because you have to have that minimum amount of firefighters on duty in order to run all that equipment. Now, he could, as chief, take a piece of equipment out of action, but that's a real dangerous thing to do, and something that only happens if you're really in desperate financial shape. You know, one of the things we could discuss, and I can say it because I live there, is close the West Side Station, take a piece of equipment.
Just having this discussion the other day.
These are all the things that are going to have to be put on the table, if not the next year, in 2 years. It's just, you have to put out like a trash fee. You have to throw it all out there and say, this is all the stuff you can think about doing. I'm not saying it's good stuff, but you know, every other community has struggled with these decisions, and many fire stations have been closed, and there's been some bad results from it, but you know, it is an option.
One other thing on the fire piece, I think I asked Greg at the selectmen's meeting about what we're charging for ambulance services, an update. And I think the selectmen agreed to it, but I'm not sure, but that would be helpful to just understand. We had been well below, or somewhat below, what other ambulance services were charging, and they made an adjustment, but that was several years ago, 3, 4, 5?
About a year and a half.
Really?
Yeah, because our fees our revenues are up quite a bit.
Right.
We're just under 800,000. We were around 600,000, 650. So it's, you know, if you remember, they raised the fees in order to add the assistant fire chief position. It's more than paid for that.
Right.
You know, they targeted 90 grand or so. It's been more.
Yeah.
So
I'd just be interested.
The general
I'd be interested to see how we are. You know, are we at market? Are we below market? Are we above market? I doubt we're above.
But and has the number of firefighters on disability gotten better?
There's less because they've retired, but there's still one that I can think of. So part of the budget amendment that you will see in April is there has been a firefighter out all or most of the year. And, you know, we thought in December, January it would be resolved. It still is not resolved. He's still not retired. So we're going to do what we did last year and ask to move his salary out of Greg's budget into the benefits area because he, for all intents and purposes, retired some time ago. You know, he hasn't worked.
So when you're saying that some have retired, do you mean a disability retirement?
Yeah. Yeah, it's been a pretty tough stretch. It's been, I think, 4.
Yeah, wow. That's very costly.
You know, out of 40, that's, that's a lot.
Yeah. Yeah, my own concern when we do that, I feel like we lose visibility to the issue.
Well, we felt it was good to move it. Sharon and I talked a lot about it before we asked Greg. It gives you the true cost of running a fire department. If someone is not working because he's not able to work or whatever, it's a formality that he hasn't yet been retired.
because... Except that's the reality we've been in for a number of years.
That's really been the last 3 or 4 years. There's been other injuries, but not retirement disability oriented, just long-term injuries.
4 years, pretty long.
I was thinking more 10 years ago. This was, you know, there was a lot of illness and sickness and serious illness, you know, out for a year or two. But it wasn't a question of you can never become a firefighter, come back as a firefighter with that injury. You know, if you had cancer, it doesn't preclude you from being a good firefighter in the future. But if, you know, if you've had hip injuries, it may well. So, you know, knock on wood, we're almost done with this. But if you've carried the cost of disabled firefighters in your fire department budget, you've overstated the cost of running a fire department. Because it's somewhat of a technicality that they weren't already being paid as pension, as a pension obligation. That's really what it is, their salary. Instead of getting, you know, pension, called pension on the paycheck, it says down at Reading. It's the difference. They're not working, they're not contributing to the department. So that's what we felt was, it was really a benefits cost at that point. And it's not to say, this is in situations where all involved are completely in agreement there should be a disability retirement. If there's dispute, we wouldn't do that. If, you know, we're saying no, and they're saying, oh yeah, then we wouldn't do this. But it's just the retirement board and some folks in Boston are just not getting the paperwork
processed
fast. They want more answers, so they want more answers, but we're all in agreement that this is, you know, a retirement.
Okay. I see.
Other questions we already know? Why don't we set a deadline for when we'll have all the questions submitted?
And I'll send you a draft on Friday or the weekend, depending on the snow. And that'll help you maybe get some questions. And what you're going to see is the department write-ups and benefits I have done. And I haven't initially finished the town manager overview, and I thought I'd do another one about what was not funded. I'm not going to bother with a three-year look ahead. I think that's somewhat insulting at this point. I thought it was helpful last year, but I can't really do that this year.
And I think in 1 year,
it's too depressing to look back at what I thought next, you know, a year ago.
1 year will be very poignant.
Yeah, yeah. The 1 year look ahead might not be so good. And anything else you can think of, if you have this from last year, if you have a budget book, go through it and see what you think is useful, what you think town meeting is useful. I'll give you, when we're going to do this tomorrow, department heads. You know, we had org charts last year. Is that useful town meeting? I don't really think so. But it might be for you.
Yep.
So there's no reason this has to be what you get. And you will see department write-ups such as this with just a bit more data in it this year. Like Greg was always good about it. But a little bit more meat. You know, we decided to start doing that with Selectmen this year and it went over well. So you get a little more behind each department. I've looked at ways other towns do budgets, and I think it's Concord. You know, their budget book's just about as thick, and the school portion is about 10% of the whole total, not like, I don't know, 75%, whatever this is. Hmm. So, you know, that's a future discussion as to what should a budget book look like. You know, I don't know. But there could be a lot more information about town departments in the budget book if you really wanted it and you thought town meeting would want it. We always just rely on everyone to ask questions instead of putting a lot of stuff out there. But in particular, when you see what we're sending out this weekend, think of other, not only questions, but what other kind of information you think you'd find helpful.
If we said, you could send it this weekend. So, if we have all questions by the 23rd of February,
that'd be fine. Honestly, you have them in early March, it's fine too.
Yeah.
We can usually get answers really fast.
Let's go for the bulk of them by for the 23rd, if there are the questions that come up.
I will do my best. I'm going to be out of the country next week, which I'm looking forward to, but it might be a little bit tricky to.
For fun?
Yes, for fun.
Oh, great.
Good.
Awesome.
Good.
When did you say you wanted the answers to each of the top snapshots, essentially?
If you fire them in to me and Bob, that actually would be great, me and Paul.
that would be great, and then we should talk them through, I think, at the second. Hopefully we'll have more information from the selectmen. We'll have had one more meeting, and we can start talking about kind of, is it appropriate, and what's the right timing for it.
So what was the other date that you just gave us?
It's Feb 23 to have questions sent back in. And again, just you can send them in, probably send them to the group and include Bob. And that means no discussion, but you can send the information one way. One other request, if there are capital project updates that are relevant, like the lights, the field lights, if there are any others that fit into that category, that would be helpful.
Give me more gray hair.
I asked that question today. Yeah, I think that's one we should talk about.
Okay.
And if there are others that...
You know, Pete used to do that at town meeting. I always thought it was interesting. I never got any feedback saying, hey, can you do that?
I think it's a great idea, personally, but...
You know, we had pictures and...
Updates on capital projects. So things that we, town meeting has approved.
Oh.
Where are they?
Yeah.
And, you know, are we tracking? Yeah, we're, you know,
so we'll make that part of your March discussion.
Yeah, that would be great.
You know, whichever department it belongs to.
Yep.
Mostly DPW and facilities now. You'll get to see facilities in a whole different light.
Yeah. Library would be a good one, because obviously this discussion for Thursday that's coming up. That's all.
Okay, that's good.
Anybody else? Comments, questions?
What's the minutes you have there?
I don't know that we do.
I
didn't see any. I'll have to check the paper.
So what's the day we're looking at for the library?
May something, right?
Good heavens.
Oh, wow.
September?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought we finished in May. Oh, what got pushed back?
Well, construction may finish in May, but the site will be ready.
What's the new stuff, is it bad?
You'll see.
I'm not gonna be there.
You'll hear.
It's getting a little tight.
There are a lot of strange, mysterious sounds that sometimes happen late at night that are presumed to be coming from the library.
Really?
Do you live there
inside?
Yes, I'm one street over.
Mm. Really?
Mm-hmm. And sometimes you'll just randomly hear a boom. How's that? of course, it doesn't necessarily have to be the library. That's the rumor that goes around the neighborhood. Huh. Did you
that's
hear
interesting.
That?
Listen, he's reading an article right now. You see
that? Yeah. I know.
I know. Library goes boom.
No question.
I think the
article.
What causes the boom?
It's a new children's book they're working on.
It's haunted.
That's right.
The new library's haunted.
Yeah.
No. I think it's time to move on, guys.
If
there's no other business before us, can I have a motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Those in favor? Opposed? We are adjourned. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.